to play some video games today. We're gonna actually play a couple games, two games that were really kind of formative games for me. I think a lot of people actually, both these games sold really well on Genesis and were some of the highest selling games that weren't a pack-in. We're gonna play both Aladdin and Lion King, which I have played a lot. They're very difficult games that I feel like a lot of people might not have gotten through. And it was in a period where, you know, you buy one game and you play it all summer and you figure it out. So I finally have beaten both these games. It's been a long time since I've played them, so I'm a little nervous about if that's gonna go well, but we'll see. And the best part is that I am joined you want to introduce yourself?
I'm Lewis Castle. I'm the co-founder of Westwood Studios. I was one who created The Lion King along with 12 other of our stalwart folks over at Westwood. And so it's a pretty small team, actually. Even back then, 13 people for two SKUs was pretty small. But it's more like indie games now, and we were just looking at the screen. This is a beautiful screen. You can actually see every single pixel, which means it looks nothing like it did back in the 90s, because all these kind of crazy, edgy pixel things. That's why I'm always kind of baffled by the old 8-bit look that people do, because those hash patterns are actually on the televisions of the day would have blurred together into very nice gradients.
Yeah.
And so, I don't know, we probably need to create a piece of software that kind of simulates the way they looked back then, because I think that's why people have a misimpression of how this stuff looked. The art was spectacular, actually. The art teams at Virgin and Westwood did a really nice job.
Yeah, it's like an intentional choice by a lot of people now to do like really stylized, interesting, epic graphics. But at the time, you were trying to probably go for a more like the Disney animated look, right?
Yeah, and they did, actually. I mean, if you look at the televisions, I'll specifically, like, I can brag on the Aladdin thing because I didn't have anything to do with Aladdin. But it does bookend Lion King nicely. But yeah, this stuff looked amazing. It was with Mike Dees, I think, that did a lot of the art. And I don't want to miscredit people, so if I've gotten that wrong, sorry. But just did an amazing job. And this is done by the team that created Shiny Entertainment, David Perry's team, Earthworm Jim, and a bunch of other games over the years. They did the Cool Spot games and Global Gladiators for Virgin. And they had done the Aladdin game. And so Aladdin is actually where the story of Lion King starts, because this game was very successful. Disney was extremely happy with it. And so Virgin was approached and said by Disney, and they said, we'd like to talk to you about doing a game based on our new Disney movie, and we can't tell you much about it, but it's going to be an animal movie based loosely around the sort of concepts of Hamlet. And so at that time, this is going to go back in time here, there wasn't an animal movie that Disney did that made any money whatsoever. They were all disasters. So they were fun movies, Oliver and Company and things like that, but they just weren't doing well. It had been years since they had a really good one.
Oh, no.
It was all princesses and princes, you know. So we were looking at it, and I said, well, you know, they were going to do it in Virgin. They had talked it through. They got the whole, I think it was probably November or so of 93. They got the deal almost put together, but at that point in time, they had a falling out with Dave Perry and his team, and so that entire team left Virgin. And so the team that built Aladdin actually did not work at all on The Lion King.
Yeah.
And they believed for a long time, until actually I talked to David later about it, that we had used their tools and their engine and everything. That's not true. Actually, what happened was, because when we took a look at the pipelines and the tools, all the people that were there had left, with Lion King, we literally started from scratch. So all we had was the Aladdin game, and we could look at the code and stuff, but really, honestly, it didn't inform us very much.
And that's why I wanted to play this first, is the Genesis version is very similar to Lion King, and I always, growing up, thought it was a similar team, because, you know, you see the Virgin logo,
think the
and you think
people,
it's a
but,
publisher, so
but,
like they're the people who make the games, and you don't understand how developer-publisher relations work. And I think there's a lot of interesting stories behind Aladdin, and people talk about that game a lot, specifically because of the fact there were so many different versions of the game. Like, this is the Genesis one that I played, and then I didn't even realize until college when I went back to play it that the Super Nintendo was a totally different game made by Capcom, and then there was a Master System game.
Right, exactly.
That was an even different team and a different game.
Same thing with Lion King, too. Lion King, we did the Super Nintendo and Genesis versions. In fact, one of the things that was asked of us is, how did you do both those versions? Did you have like did you use the Aladdin thing and get it ported over? And actually, no, not true. We actually built our own cross-platform system. So we literally built an engine to do Lion King from the ground up, specifically to do that game based on the success of Aladdin and how Aladdin was done.
Yeah.
Now, the methodologies that were used, that were invented by the guys that that ended up being Shiny, we certainly did follow the suit on that.
So yeah, there's a lot of stuff like the checkpoint systems and these like little
mini-games. The game design is hugely informed, at the least, you know, but also the production process. So we, as part of the deal with Disney, we had to use Disney Animation to do all the animation. That was
It's awesome. It shows, and that's one of the things I think is called out a lot, is like in the argument of Genesis versus Super Nintendo, is that the Genesis version actually had animators from Disney on the game, and that it had a sword in the game.
Well, we actually literally hired, I don't mean just they worked at it, I'll tell you more of the story as we get into Lion King, mm-hmm. but so the start of Lion King from Aladdin was, all of it looked great. We were going to do a small team in Vegas to help offset some of the stuff. Dave and his team all leave Virgin, and we get no assistance whatsoever, so I literally had to build the team from scratch. And it was right after the meeting at Disney. So we go to Disney, I'm like really hesitant, I don't know if I want to do it. They said, oh, you'll have a lot of help from the team and you'll have the tools and, you know, it won't be so bad and all this. And so they say, well, watch the first 15 minutes or 10 minutes or 5 minutes, whatever it was, of the film, the whole intro to The Lion King. And if you don't feel inspired, then fine, we'll just drop the thing. Well, of course, I watched it.
Yeah, and it's
and I was just
amazing.
Blown away. I mean, almost to tears. I was like, oh my God, it was absolutely gorgeous. I'm a bit of a Disney dork when I was a kid too. Yeah. I loved all the Disney films. So I said, fine, we're signed up. We signed the deal, and literally about a week or two after signing the deal, we find out that Dave and his whole team have left Virgin, and now we're on our own. My wife was pregnant with twins at the time, and so she was due to deliver about midway through production. Mm. That's always fun, too.
Yeah.
actually, a little bit right in the beginning of production. So we put together our team of 13 and started building the game. I guess while we're doing the Aladdin stuff, we can talk about the process. So the way this is done, the way the art was done, is you would actually build the level and build the things. Now, the way that animators work on, especially Disney animators, they don't do Hanna-Barbera loops, right? Walk loops and things like that. That's just really not what they do. They mm-hmm. literally put the film together one scene at a time, just like an actor or a director would do it. So what we had to do is we'd have to do animations of the characters. We'd describe what the level was going to be, the kinds of things the characters would do, and Disney would animate it as if it was a linear short. Then the artists on the art team would have to try to, they would literally take the light box of the images and overlay them onto graph paper and graph them out, and then almost pixel by pixel, painstakingly, they would scan them, but that would give you a really rough, ugly look of it. They would literally go through pixel by pixel and hand fine tune the character to try to capture the nuance of the curves and stuff that were in the characters. Mm-hmm. And more importantly, certainly with Aladdin, the animators were not being directed by a video game team, so the video game guys had to actually figure out how to make those things loop without popping horribly. And so it was really, really tough yep. problem for any of those artists watching this. You can imagine how difficult it would be to take these exquisitely animated pieces that where the character might turn 5 degrees and decide, okay, no, actually I can't have him turn because he'll pop. I have to kind of translate that. And so a lot of work. And hats off to the team. They did a beautiful job on this game. Even today, this game just looks spectacular.
It looks amazing. For sure. And I think that a lot of the silhouettes of the characters and things like that just feel a lot more kind of similar to the ones in the movie for this game.
Well, yeah, and because it really was the animating team that did it, you know, and interestingly, they, you know, when you look at the silhouettes, it's called with the character Reed, and that's one of the things that they teach you in art school early on, as I have a background in fine arts
There's
as well.
There's so much stuff in this game too, like this right here, where it's just knowing to hit up on this.
Yeah, on that column.
To come up into this secret area. And Lion King is the same way, where there's just
tons of them, yeah.
Ton of hidden stuff behind geometry that looks like you can't actually walk through it. And that's perfect for like the period of time it was in my life where I'm spending an entire summer playing this game, because the game is hard and it's something that I probably had to play, you know, dozens and dozens of times before I was able to finish it. And every time there's like one new secret you find that's got an extra life or a continue back there and makes it just a little bit easier to get to the end. But even still, like, I think the muscle memory stuff is starting to come back.
Yeah, you're doing pretty well.
But even still, I feel like I need those lives and continues to get through. It's pretty challenging. And it's actually about to get, after this level, I think, is the dungeon level, and that's where things start getting really interesting for sure.
Oh, yeah. Well, like I said, the interesting thing about Lion King, or Aladdin when it comes to Lion King, is it actually bookends the development of Lion King. I talked a little bit about the beginning of it, which was a really kind of crazy start to a project. And I do want to save the Lion King comments for Lion King. That's mm-hmm. why I'm kind of shutting up now, because really, having not worked on Aladdin, the last part of it is coming back to Aladdin, after Lion King, so pretty interesting. Oh yeah, you're getting into the...
Yeah, maybe there are a lot of similarities. I mean, we talked about the animation, but even in the game design and stuff, there's...
Yeah, we definitely tried to make sure that the Lion King game was, you know, inspired by and borrowed as much as possible from Aladdin. It's just that we didn't have the benefit of using the same tech, so we had to actually sort of start over. So, but that helped a lot. I mean, you know, those guys did a wonderful job on this.
Yeah, and it's even things like, there's a lot of different mechanics within each level. Like, this level has this interesting thing where I'm trying to gather all of these flutes to get through, so it's got a little bit of a kind of puzzle-y exploration thing. But there's, like, the Magic Carpet Ride level later on that's very similar to, like, the Stampede level in
Got a big story about the Stampede level.
Yeah.
So.
But it's just nice to see that, like, I feel like a lot of people might have only seen the first couple levels of these games because they're so challenging, but there's so much variety in, like, location and game mechanics in this game that... I think people should get out of this Let's Play, hopefully, be able to see a little bit of new stuff that they haven't seen before.
Yeah, hopefully. You know, especially if you can get all the way to the Lion King, hats off.
We'll see. We'll see about
that. It's really the monkey puzzle. If you can get past the monkey puzzle, you're in good shape.
I can do that. I think my hardest level in Lion King is... actually, the Elephant Graveyard's really tough.
Elephant Graveyard's very tough on purpose.
Yeah, Cave of Wonders, I think, is the one that people really get stuck on a lot, or the escape from Cave of Wonders. But
for this one, yeah.
I mean, the escape from the...
Elephant Graveyard?
What is it called? The cavern, like the fiery cavern level?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I don't remember what it's called. Yeah. But that one...
The Burning Pride Lands, I don't remember what we called it, but yeah, so yeah, I know exactly what you meant.
It has no checkpoints to one of these levels, so that makes it tough.
The end when you battle Scar, that last move was very challenging,
we'll
too.
We'll talk about that for sure. Cool.
So that was actually all very intentional. We'll get into Lion King in a minute.
Yeah, definitely.
Like I said, I'm probably talked about as much as I can about the Aladdin game without... talking about Lion King a lot.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was really well done. These guys, like I said, happy to be following in their footsteps, standing on the shoulders of giants when it came to great platform game design.
Totally.
And the team actually at Westwood for Lion King included two people that were from Virgin Games at the time, Seth Mendelson and Eric Yeo. Both those guys were really solid game designers. And Seth is a big Disney fan. I think he ended up working at Disney afterward, and I'm not sure if he's still there, but.
There's a secret. Did you see that one?
There you go, yeah.
Pretty good. All right. Well, should we move to Lion King, you guys? What do you think?
Yeah.
Yeah, because I want to give us time to make sure we can get to the end of that one.
You can always come back on this one, save your progress, right?
yeah, I wish, right? There we go, another secret. They love that. That's actually, that was one that took me forever, there's that monkey way up top, and you have to fall and hold the jump button before you hit it to get an extra bounce.
And that's it.
Secrets. All right, shall we? I just died too, so perfect timing. Oh man, and those death animations are so awesome, but they get so frustrating later on.
It's just awesome that you have functional Genesis and SNES to go play these on.
Yeah, I played it through emulation and stuff recently, but actually putting the cartridge in and hitting the power button is a whole different thing.
With any luck. Yes.
There we go.
Sega.
Yeah, so I played these a couple days ago, again, for the first time since college, just to like make sure I could still get through. And... I didn't, like, as soon as I turned it on, it was just, like, immediate joy. I was, like, immediately brought back to being a little child, like, so excited about playing it again. And so I was going in here, and I was going to put it on easy the first time just to make sure I could get through, and then I realized, you can't play all the way through the game on easy, right?
You can.
I thought that there was, maybe it's Aladdin.
You can play through the whole game on easy, but you will miss some of the secret level stuff.
Okay.
There's secret
One of them, like, stops, like, after six levels or so, and is like, play on normal. I think it must be Aladdin.
Not my recollection. But maybe, we had a couple of things that were changed in the 11th hour. So let's start with the
fire it up.
Right off the bat, the start screen there, it said the Animation Studios. So part of our deal with Disney was we had to use the Disney Animation Studios as our thing. So I love these guys, right?
Yeah.
So we had to use them as our animators, but we were happy to use them. Of course, it's Disney animators, which is awesome. But in addition to that, they were also the ones that were approving the Disney software... the Disney software. So they worked for us, but we also worked for them, which made this circular loop, which I would never recommend ever doing again. It was just a nightmare. And it wasn't because they're bad guys. They were so passionate about the animation. We were constantly kind of having to educate them about what made good gameplay. Like, one of the things you're doing a lot of is moving in midair. If you jump into midair on a platformer, and you go the other direction, you turn around.
Yep.
And the animation pops horribly, and the animators just hated that. They said, well, once the lion has leaped into the air, it defies physics to turn around midair. We don't want that. So we had to have many, many debates about the fact that the game just wouldn't be playable if you didn't let us do that. The artwork, too, the character, you notice the character is much more modeled, almost like a 3D model. Again, going back to Aladdin, Aladdin 2, which we had proposed to Disney, used pre-rendered 3D models, because Westwood was very much into 3D at the time, and that project didn't take off. We'll talk about it later. Didn't get done, but shortly thereafter, they did Donkey Kong Country in the same style. It was beautiful. So the lion and all the characters have a certain, they're not as, they look much more rounded and much more 3D than even the Aladdin characters, specifically to try to sort of hint toward the future of 3D models in games.
Nice.
Yeah.
And I just almost got a secret and then accidentally rolled out. We're gonna go back down there.
Go down there.
Yeah. So like already in this first level, there's so much of needing to get that bug to extend my health meter and my growl meter, my roar meter. And I feel like all of that stuff is really tricky platforming super early on. And it's something that, you know, I talked to Tim a lot. He grew up on PC games where I grew up on like 8-bit stuff. And it's a lot of challenging platformers and things. And so when new games come out, like Super Meat Boy or something like that, those are like totally right up my alley. And he's just like, and I did exactly the same thing.
Yep.
But I feel like it was just games like this that were just like, they didn't treat you like you were a child, and they expected that you could kind of figure them out and feel your way around. And I don't know, I think that just kind of prepared me a little bit more for these more difficult games now.
I'll tell you, the platformers that exist now, the free-to-play and the independent guys, some of those guys are brutally hard. And I made some pretty hard platformers in my life.
There we go.
There you go.
Continue.
Circle
All
of
right.
life, yeah.
We might need that later.
That's it. Work on your roar, you know?
I know. See, and that was the other thing. When I came back to play this, I immediately was just like muscle memory playing it exactly how I did when I was 12 years old.
Yeah.
And so I was just like not growling at people, like running straight through them and just trying to get to the next checkpoint. I'm like, this is not at all how I would be playing this if I was playing it now. So trying to be a little bit more.
So the artwork, too, is an interesting one. You know, when we started the game, we started in January of 1994, and the game did ship in July, which is pretty incredible considering we had to start from scratch. One of the things that was really challenging was all we got were background images and the first few minutes of the film, because they were still working on the film. Disney was tightened down really, really tight and wasn't giving us any assets. Not because anybody was, you know, being evil or anything. They just simply had so many controls on the assets. So a lot of our team had to work on stuff based on really kind of sketchy and barely anything as far as plates go. I mean, we probably got a few hundred drawings, and that was it.
All right, here's your part. Roar at monkeys.
Yeah, the monkeys.
We're here.
Yeah, the swinging monkeys.
We were talking about this a little bit before we started. And I think this
they
was...
They toss you around and,
This was probably a stopping point for a lot of people, honestly.
Well, let me tell you why this was. So the monkey puzzle was meant to be about that long, right, what you just did. And what happened was, at the time, Blockbuster had these rental program that had just come out, and Disney had a rule across all of its products that you couldn't get past a certain percentage of the game in a certain period of time. So the only level in the early levels where we had the ability in the 11th hour, literally, to make it longer and more complicated was the monkey puzzle inside at the end of this level.
And it totally makes sense now, but as a child, I was like, what is going on
here?
Yeah,
why is it so hard? The hippos and the
well,
and
that's that was actually, so this is like the path it seems you're supposed to take is these tails on the bottom, but like when I discovered you could just jump straight up to this,
just grabbing
like,
by the ear,
gosh,
so much easier. That's a secret. You can go the other way too, if I'm not mistaken. I think
you can. Yeah, it's just a lot harder. And same thing here, you can jump straight over to this guy.
Yep. And so anyways, that's why this level is so hard. Apologies to all the people who ever pulled out their hair on this, including myself. But the reason we had to do it was because the rental market was, people would rent a game, and if they got a certain distance in the game, the metrics from Disney said they wouldn't buy the game. I don't know if it's actually true. I think the quality of the game would have carried them all the way through, but that's because I'm a game maker, and so I would have wanted to complete it.
Well, this is tricky here, too. You've removed the prompts now for this jump puzzle, so it's all like either memorization or really paying attention to what's coming.
Yep. And that's actually, again, all of that was done specifically because the game had to have we really couldn't let you pass level two too fast. After level two, the game is built as an oscillation, so the first level was quite easy to get through, although you couldn't find all the secrets unless you were good. This is the puzzle, yeah.
This is the tough one. This
puzzle was added literally to make the game harder so you wouldn't be able to get through it too quickly on rental.
Yeah, so what's happening is if you roar at these pink monkeys, they change the direction that they'll throw you. And there's a very complex kind of back and forth pattern you have to actually make to get all the way through to the end of the level. But this is the end of the level if you can just solve this puzzle.
Exactly.
But yeah, it took me a few times on my last playthrough to remember.
And you gotta reverse the monkey.
Gotta reverse that guy.
You gotta go to the other monkey.
Whoops, didn't want to do that.
Nope. And you gotta be worried because if you fall into those monkeys' hands, man, they throw you all over the place.
Yeah, exactly. And now there's a tricky jump puzzle to get back.
Exactly. And this is it. Yep.
Got it.
Oh God, I remember that.
Yeah. Okay, now what though? I think now that I've roared at him, I'm good to try
again.
I think you did it. And then he'll throw me back up there, and I have to, yeah. Okay, I think we got it.
I think so. It's been a long time. And you asked me earlier when the last time I played this, probably 1995.
That's awesome.
So it's been that long.
Well, hopefully there'll be some things in here you don't remember.
Oh no, I don't know.
Gotta get that. All right, so that's the bonus level right there we just unlocked.
Yep, gotta get the bug.
And now I think we're good.
Yeah, you really did play this a lot because that's another one which a lot of people don't realize where to find. They see the bug, they just don't know how to get the bug to get the bonus level.
Those are so important too, like I said, because that bonus level, if I play it right, should get me a continue. No, wait. Now that we've done him, I think we just do this guy. No? We reverse him, and then we're good.
Find out in a second.
Boom. All right, see?
Well, you're not dying, which is good, yeah.
Now he'll throw me to the pink guy.
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah, now he tosses me.
See, before
you
would have just thrown me straight down.
There
yeah, there we go. We're
there
out.
There you go. Done.
All right.
Down the giraffe. And I think in the beginning you had to actually jump off that one, which was terrible.
Yeah, so now it's
bug hunt.
Don't touch the black ones.
That's right. Don't eat the
spiders. I try to be just so safe and not
spiders
even try to get
icky.
The ones that are close to them. So if I can get five more, I have a continue. There we go.
There you go. Nice.
Much needed.
And, you know, the guys in the test department would get... would get all of them.
Yeah, I'm
like,
sure.
Like, just stupid sure. good, yeah. Elephant Graveyard.
Yeah.
So this is now, I talked
first
about that game design.
Battle.
One of the things we did in all of the Westwood games is we used to chart out the difficulty of the games, and we tried to make, we tried to bring up the difficulty level and then give people a break again and oscillate between them so that you're not just constantly escalating the difficulty.
This is, I think, one of the hardest levels in the game.
Right,
sure.
This was meant to be this hard, and the last level was not meant to be hard.
Mm-hmm.
So this was how we wanted to originally, we thought this was good enough, as it were, to put the pressure on people for rentals, and that was when Disney came back and said, no, our test audience was able to get through it. But of course, they were testing with kids that had played Aladdin, and if you had played Aladdin, you could get through The Lion King pretty easily. Relatively speaking. And it's also one of the reasons you mentioned earlier that Lion King is harder than Aladdin is because there was a distinct effort to make sure that the people buying the game, we're going to have a more challenging time on the newer game. So the sort of presumption, or the games were built with the presumption that you'd be playing them in series.
Yeah.
And there were a couple things on this one, too. You can see it looks a little bit like the Pride Lands, but now we were starting to get in some of the cooler programming where we had the parallaxing in the background and stuff like that to give you a little bit more sense of depth. And again, it doesn't do it justice when you see it all pixelated because on our television of the day, this was all very smooth and the palettes really matched the beautiful.
I think
work
the art just is so good that it actually holds up like that. And
yeah,
it's definitely not how it looked when I played it on my TV growing up, but now it's kind of rad. I kind of like seeing those pixels like that. It gives you appreciation for the artists and what they've done.
Oh yeah, they did a beautiful job. I mean, when you think about the resolution, there's just not a lot of pixels on the screen there, you know? And this is like, this would be the size of a postage stamp on your phone, you know? it's amazing.
All right, so far so good. I swear I missed some stuff back there, but I think
okay.
I think there's a lot of things that require like buzzard bouncing or something.
Buzzard bouncing, off those guys. Yeah, you have to jump into the air and bounce off them.
That is not easy.
Yep. And you have to actually do the down and the thump at the same time. It's kind of like a wall jump in Metroid, but you know what? I wouldn't even attempt it myself, so it's amazing that you're doing this well.
This is not, that was lucky right there to get through there, but.
Watch it. You're losing some life meter there.
Yeah. This is tricky. A lot of this is also, if you go far enough, they won't come with you. So sometimes it's like balancing just running versus.
Yep, exactly.
This is tricky jump. There we go. All right, so far so good. This is the worst.
I'm impressed.
This always made me so angry because you have to kill this buzzard, and if you fall here, you're at the beginning of the level again.
That's right.
And it makes me nervous every time. We got it. Okay.
Yep, because if you don't do that, he'll get you on the other side, and then you're done.
Yeah, and now another hard hyena battle.
Which one is it, Shenzi and Ed, right? Nope. Shenzi? I can't remember their names.
Now this is the end of the level, but...
These are the generic hyenas, actually. Don't have the characters
tricky.
Yet.
Yeah. No!
There you go, they salute.
Final guy. Can I do it in one life?
You can do it. Bang! You gotta get under him, and wait till he gets tired.
Boom!
Slam!
Oh my gosh, that went so much better than last time.
And down the spine you go, yay!
All right.
And there's Scar.
Yeah, man.
A lot of people miss Scar. It's like, come on, he's right there.
Subtle. Yeah. All right.
Now you're on the bug toss, because you got it. Nice. You got to do the bug toss. And these were another things back in the day, you know, mini games were actually a big deal. Again, such a beautiful, this one scene was one of my favorites too. This one and the monkey, the monkey on the waterfall is so gorgeous.
Oh yeah, the monkey level is rad.
Just I think so beautiful.
That's probably the prettiest level.
Let's
talk about this.
So here's the story with this one. So we're about a month or two into development, maybe, I hadn't gone to Florida yet, so it had to be about March. And we go in and we're gonna pitch this level to the Disney team over at Disney Interactive. And we got word ahead of time, thankfully, because we had a mole in there, and I won't say who it was, because you get them in trouble probably to this day. But they said, hey, you're the technical guy over at Disney is going to kill the wildebeest level because they don't want to compromise the delivery schedule. And so the team was just like
distraught. All new assets, right? Everyone's drawn from like the front.
Oh yeah, so it's like this. So we said, there's no way, that's not going to happen. So about maybe a week before, we actually stopped everything and built the level. So we actually, before we got approval, we made it work.
That's awesome.
And so we were in the meeting and we had the game all ready to go and we were right before this level. And we get in there and then the technical director launches into this diatribe about how the specification was way too aggressive and 3D on a Super Nintendo. This is the Genesis version. The Super Nintendo is even smoother. You know, it was just not going to be possible in the time frame that we had. And he was going on and on. And while he was telling everybody how challenging and how difficult and it was not going to be possible, we started playing the level. And they're like, and he goes, well, I guess if you did it, you did it. I'm not even sure why we're having this meeting. I'm going, well.
Well, and it became, I think it's probably the most commonly cited favorite level.
Oh, it's
just so
level.
Unique and different and such a change of pace.
It was very hard to do. Barry Green and Rob Povey, the programmers, Barry was on the,
Super
which one? I think Barry was the Super Nintendo and Rob was the Genesis. And those guys, they really worked, I mean, all-nighters. Not because somebody was saying, hey, you know, if you don't come in on Saturday, don't bother to come in Sunday, but actually because they love the game and they just wanted it to be awesome. And so when people talk about crunch, it's like the right reason to crunch is because you just love it and you just want it to be better, right?
Yeah.
That's the right reason to crunch. So those guys are, they were amazing and still, I lost touch with both of them, but would still regard them as some of the best times I've ever had making games. They were just awesome.
That's awesome.
They did not get on well sometimes, very in a comical sort of way, so it was good.
So we have something new going on in this level, which is that you basically have to speedrun this level. Oops, that was bad.
Yes.
There's like the rocks that are always constantly falling if you stay in one place too long.
Yes,
so.
Exactly. You don't have to rush in the sense that you can go slowly.
Yeah.
You just have to be. You can't stay in one spot. Yeah, exactly. So there was a time when this level had the frequency of the rocks increase as well, and we determined that was just way too hard. Because as you get further and further in the level, of course, the level gets more difficult, and the rocks started falling so fast that you just...
I like how you end to where you have to run into the brambles, even though the brambles have been like the death of the entire level.
It's like you have to do that leap of faith. Oh!
Another bug.
Luau! We missed the audio. How come we didn't see the animation? Oh, there was like there's an animation of Timon that he does that thing from the movie.
Yeah.
He goes, Luau!
I must have skipped it or something. All right, now
there we go.
Here we're talking about some pretty art.
Yeah, this is just inspired. So this art is inspired by plates that were in the film that nobody ever saw. So one of the rules at Disney is you're never supposed to talk about the artwork that gets cast aside, but I got to because it's in the game.
Yeah, there you go.
So here's what happened. So we were in a meeting in, now it's probably May or so, we're sitting in the meeting at in Orlando, Florida, and we actually did end up being in Orlando with the animation team working on the game to accelerate the time frame. Anthony Michael and a bunch of guys that were just really amazing animators. So we're in the meeting and Jeffrey Katzenberg comes in and we're doing a big storyboarding thing, and there's a point in time in the story, and I don't know if you guys all know the movie Lion King, but there's a point in time in the story where the lion grows up. He goes from being a cub to being an adult. Well, and then after that, they go from being an adult to the Pride Lands, right? So the decision from when he decides he's going to be an adult to the time when he ends up in the Pride Lands was a lot of film. There was a bunch of scenes and everything that were designed and storyboarded, and Katzenberg's looking at this whole wall and he goes, you know, how do the characters develop? How does the story get any better? What happens from this decision point to when he shows up in the Pride Lands? And everybody starts talking about, oh, well, he goes on his adventures and he does this and he meets the monkeys and he does all, and they goes, yeah, but nothing happens. The character made the decision to go back and he's not, this is a story of the story of a coming of life, a coming of age story. And he as a character doesn't progress. Simba doesn't progress at all. Let's just cut all of it. So, of course, this video game team is like, wait, you're cutting like half our game, right? So it took a long time, actually, because we had these levels were all developed. And we're like, look, we can't cut all that stuff. And he goes, well, you've got all the other story stuff. I was like, no, you don't understand. We can't cut everything. It's just too much stuff to cut. The game is going to be like empty with all those levels. So it literally took Paul Carossi and some of the guys at Virgin to appeal to Katzenberg to please let us, and Disney Animation to please let us keep the artwork in the game. And so the thought was, well, nobody will really know that the artwork was supposed to be in the movie in the first place anyways, but now you do. So there you go.
I was wondering about that, because there are a lot of levels with adult Simba, which, spoilers, is about to happen.
Yep.
And that, I mean, that was one of the coolest things of the game for me, was the way that you change your main character halfway through the game.
And
but all of that stuff, like you said, was not stuff that was from the movie, so I wondered how much of it was just to be able to, like, utilize all those new mechanics that come with adult Simba.
Yeah, no,
but it sounds like that's not at all what it was.
No, it was actually inspired by plates and storyboards and things from the movie that never got made.
Yeah.
Well, actually, they did get made. They were taken to a pretty far degree of production and then cast aside because you know, Jeffrey was just not convinced that they were germane to the film, which I had a lot of respect for. I mean, as a company, to be able to take that kind of pride, no pun intended, in their work, to say, look, we're just going to make it great, and if it costs money, oh well, we want to make the best product. And so it taught us a lot. I mean, honestly, I think it kind of influenced the way Westwood thought about games after that, too, because we started getting very non-compromising when it came to quality. People would get aggravated at us because we'd go to three or four trade shows thinking we were going to ship a game, but if we weren't happy with it, we pretty much didn't ship it. I think Blizzard has taken that to an extreme, and it shows in the quality of their products. But it's a tough call. From a business point of view, it's a really tough call to keep working on something when you know you just spent a lot of money on it. And there's nothing wrong with it. It just wasn't optimal.
Yeah. Well, the fans can notice, right? That's why it sticks around.
Yeah.
All right, we're almost to your monkey.
Yeah, I know, he's awesome. Watch the spiders.
Yeah. Right,
bastards.
This is obviously not from the
movie
either,
really,
so where did this guy come from?
This is actually part of the, when he enjoys the Pride. No, he wasn't.
Is he in there?
This character, no, he's not in the movie.
Okay.
He was originally.
Okay,
as part of the Pride Land adventures, the Pride Land things. So this character was created by Disney Animation. The video game team did not create any of the characters. All the stuff came from Disney material. So, and obviously he wasn't. I don't remember him throwing coconuts. That might just be a game mechanic. But that whole look of the silverback. I don't know if you guys have ever watched Real Gorillas, but the animators the animators at Disney. Used to do a lot of, they did a lot of research, obviously, on the characters. And silverbacks will sit there with their back to you like this and just kind of look over their shoulder at you with really annoyed look on their face. It's amazing.
This was a pretty tricky one, too. Some weird patterns in here.
Oh, yeah.
And he always jumps in weird ways and then jumps on you like he almost just did.
Yep.
And there's a lot of, if you miss a jump like that, now he's going to be throwing a bunch of barrels when I get up there. If I could have gotten there the first spot, I would have been able to avoid some.
Yeah, he'll be throwing coconuts at you.
Yeah.
Well, you gotta let him go. I always love that, too, the scramble. There's some really neat scenes. You know, the animators really did do such a beautiful job on some of the character animations, the kind of idols and stuff like that, too.
There's so much detail.
You've been
there.
Jumping through this pretty fast, so you don't see many of the idols. And there's a lot of idols where they're like, I don't remember which ones went in, the smack, the backhand.
Yeah, if you get too close to him, he'll hit you.
Sorry.
Which is tough when I'm on this tiny little
apologies
platform.
Apologies to the audio guys there.
Ugh, there we go.
Oh, there you go.
All right. Adult cinema time, I think.
Ooh, that look. You gotta love it.
And the little like wavy hands are super awesome.
Yeah. Very cute.
Okay, let's see if we can get another free guy. Or
I wonder what happened to Luau. You know, I wonder if it didn't make it in the Genesis version. I know that the memory cartridges were, the assets took different sizes. One of the reasons Westwood games, even on consoles, were doing a lot more assets than others was we had invented a number of really good lossless compression. And so we were compressing almost all the assets in our games. So it was very avant-garde at the time, I would say.
Yeah, they looked awesome for sure.
We were able actually, and there was lossless compression, so we didn't have like JPEG where you'd lose anything. And there you go, Aladdin.
And now we're Adult Simba.
Yeah.
Very exciting. So now we have a whole new moveset. We've got slashes.
Yeah, you can.
We can maul, if I can do it.
And then you have the orange fur, because we weren't allowed to do blood. So that's orange fur, I want everybody to know, that you're slashing at them with.
Oh, I didn't even notice that.
When you hit them, there's like this flash of fur. It's like, yeah, that's orange fur. It's not blood, really.
This level is always great, too, because it's like, one, it's just exciting to be Adult Simba now, but it's a little bit easier of a level, too.
And that's, again, very intentional to get the ease back up and also let you explore a new character. And, you know, those annoying monkeys, now you get a chance to have some revenge. Although they're still throwing I guess, what do you think they're throwing?
Some sort of nut?
Why not?
But I think it could be something else.
Yeah, it could be. It was something else. It was obviously something else. They made us take that out. It's like, oh, come on.
Funny.
Kids love poo jokes.
I could see why they might be
they didn't
weary
like it.
Of that.
Yeah, but it was funny, you know, because you get hit by it, and we had this look on the lion's face. It's like, ugh, you know, that went away.
So that's one of the most
powerful
attacks.
Back feet, rake.
Yeah, then there's the backflip, which let me see if I can do that.
Well, you can't flip him. You have to do the rake. Yeah, that's it.
Well, I can flip him, though, right? Once he gets panty.
Yes, if you do. Yes. That's how you learn it.
Boom.
Boom, yeah.
We'll talk about that later.
Yep. It's the only move. You have to master that move by the last level.
Yeah, and it's never taught, right? So
That's right.
It took me so long to figure out how that was happening because it just accidentally happens all the time. And I'm like,
what?
And I just always assumed it was kind of, you know, just random thing.
Oh no!
Until you eventually have to do it.
Yeah. See. Now he like looks. He reaches down and picks up a nut off the ground and throws it to you. There was something else they used to do that that was, I thought, very funny. It came from
the
animators.
I'm sure it was.
Yeah, it came from the animators. We didn't do it. It's funny that the you know, the team is always just like anything else. The team and animation, they have some really humorous stuff they do that they can never talk about with the characters, which is hysterical.
So. All right, there's a nice little hidden continue down there.
See it down there? Yep. And one of the design principles was if you played the game without finding the secret, without like not looking for the secret areas, every secret area had some sort of a tell. So you would always see a little bit. In Aladdin, there were a few that were completely blind.
Yeah, when we just launched up that bowl.
Yeah, and we decided not to do that with Lion King. We felt like it would be fair, even if it was very subtle, like a little bit of a glowing silver or gold coming through the leaves, always a little bit of something to tell you where it was. God, those cheetahs, pumas, cheetahs, wherever they were tough, man.
It's fun, though. I mean, the game just becomes a lot more combat-focused now.
Yeah, exactly.
It's interesting.
And we wanted a much more adult game. And as you pointed out, I mean, we chose to tell the story in the same order as the movie, we really couldn't bring Adult Simba in sooner. So you have to bring him about halfway through the story. But it was a bit of a shame because I think a lot of people didn't even realize there was this really fun combat game in here too. And not a lot of platformers during the day would have hand-to-hand combat like this. In fact, most of them were all throwing things, you know. And Rafiki hits you with his club.
Here we go.
Yeah, watch the rolling rocks.
Yeah, one hit kills on those rocks. That is brutal.
And there's something too about, I don't know if you guys, well, actually they're seeing us while we hear us talk over it, but the weight of the lion, when he runs, you feel the weight of him. You know, it's like really cool. He's not bouncy like the little cub was, and that to me always was just really beautifully done.
Yeah, he definitely has a different feel to it. And seems like a little bit wider of an animation suite, but I guess you can't have the roll anymore now, which is one of the things I used a lot as young Simba.
Well, but again, intentionally changing the mechanics up and making it so that you you had to learn, and now he has a real roar.
His roar is much more badass, and it actually kill that guy, right? If it was full.
Yeah, well, we'll it would have. Yeah. I think you get him from there, yeah. As it, the first, not only is it more powerful, but it actually, as you pointed out, it actually has a greater range when you're when it's full, when the meter's full.
Let's see if we can. There we go.
Yep.
Secrets.
Slash slash slash.
Now I've got a powerful roar.
Yeah, now you're all full. Well, almost not. Not quite full. Ooh. Punk.
Right.
And then there's some, I mean, you probably know because you probably did them all, but there are some secrets that you actually have to preserve your roar because the only way to get to it is to use a roar.
Yeah.
So there's a few of those too.
Yeah, and it took me a while as a child to, you know, you ignore the UIs and stuff to realize that, like, full roars are necessary for actually flipping over some of those guys.
Exactly.
And stuff like that.
I think, was it necessary for Scar? I can't remember.
I don't
Maybe not.
Believe so.
And I like that too, where Rafiki clears the way and gives you your continue point. That's nice.
And now we get to see Father in the sky.
Luke. No, sorry,
yeah.
Wrong movie.
Have you seen the musical?
Yeah, oh yeah.
The musical's amazing too. Like, I love the movie. I've seen it, like, saw it in theaters when it first came out, saw it in IMAX when it came to IMAX, and then 3D. But then, yeah, the stage musical is also just
interesting. Oh, it was amazing. And the actual, before the musical, they did a launch event in Chicago for the game, and they had all the performers that ended up doing the musical, and it was like going to a Baptist revival. I mean, they had all the gospel singers there and everything, and they had cheese statues that were the size of these characters. I don't know what Disney spent a lot of money on it, because it really was more, for them, it really wasn't about making money on the video games, although I think it did quite well. I know it did quite well. It was actually for them more about making sure the brand got promoted. And it changed the way that I thought about making licensed properties. And after doing Lion King as a designer and as a creator, I went on to do Monopoly and then Blade Runner. And
nice.
This game taught me that the most important thing you can do with any franchise is be its biggest fan and make sure that any kind of licensed property adds to the value of the franchise and doesn't borrow from it. And so that was something I got out of Disney for sure. They really honestly didn't care so much as if the game made money. They cared more about, is the game going to add people to the sort of wonder and feeling of love of the actual brand, the franchise.
And now we're at a very challenging level,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, very tough.
This is the other one. I think Elfin Graveyard and this one are.
Yeah, this is meant to be the. This is one of the scenes that was storyboarded out and everything, and they just didn't make it into the film, of when Simba's heading back to the Pride Lands and he goes through the geysers, the molten geysers, basically. They're not. It's not lava, although it certainly looks like that. It was these hot steam geysers and everything. So an underground thing, and again. Inspired by a few panels and drawings and some stuff that just didn't make it. It'd be surprising, I think, to most people how much artwork is created for films that doesn't ever make it in.
For sure. Oh man, those drips are so
yeah.
hard too, and you can't see them until they come. You just kind of have to memorize exactly where they are. We're almost through the checkpoint, though.
Yeah, from here you can't see them. When you're up close enough to the ceiling, you can see this light bubble kind of
that
start.
One, like, oddly stops too when yeah. you're down below, which yeah. is nice because you can't really see it, but
there
always makes me scared.
Yep. Swipe, swipe. Nice.
All right, checkpoint. All right, this is pretty tricky. Those bats are.
Yep.
Although I got lucky there and one didn't spawn. Actually, a couple didn't spawn. Nice.
I think as you're all the way forward, you managed to catch the, yep. If you were a little bit further back on your rock there, you would probably had a few more.
Good trick. I'm gonna do that every time now. I think the free guys aren't appearing either. I don't know if it's because I'm full or something. But let's see.
Yeah, you've got so many.
There should have been one there.
I see, now you got them, yeah.
There we go.
There he is. He's spawning.
There, now it's there. I must have just been
yep.
maxed out or something.
Yeah, he had, I think 8 might be it. I'm not sure. That's something, it's not a problem that I ever had. I have too many free guys. It's like, no, barely making it through. That would be me.
I think that my luck might be running out soon. This is going to get real here.
There you go. Nice.
Now a boulder that will kill me.
Nicely done. Oh, stupid
bats. Yeah.
They're so hard when you're inside the narrow passages. You know, you have no room to maneuver, so.
Oh, tapping, he'll just go away. There we go.
Those guys in the monkeys inspired by the, there was a game, Gauntlet, that had the little guys that threw the rocks at you. It's like, oh, that's a great idea. It's really annoying.
All right. I think this is it, right?
Yep. Gotta crouch down. Do the reverse. They'll be waiting for you.
Mm-hmm. Come on. Ending's a little tricky, too, on this level, because it looks like you're kind of stuck and nowhere to go.
Yep. Oh, yeah. It's been a long time since I've seen this, so. I mean, no joke. Damn near 20 years, I guess.
So, yeah, this is just an exercise in staying alive.
Yep. Oh, yeah, the rocks. The only safe place is on the geyser that's about to cook you.
The next level was one that made me very glad that I played through this before time, because now we're going to get to the like Mario-style ghost level that has kind of a maze through a bunch of series of doors. I think I remember the pattern. We'll see.
Now, do you know if you had to wait that many?
I think that eventually the rocks will just start falling, right? Yep, there we go. Oops.
There you go. I'm suspicious that there was probably a way you had to get further to cause them to trigger, but that's I'm not sure. But if that works for you, whatever.
Well, now we're good. And
you plug them all and then blast off. There you go.
Okay, so now.
Oh, yes.
Really like the color palette of this level. Super pretty.
Yeah, the just decimated Pride Lands.
So these are all doors.
Yes, they are.
And we got to go through the right ones, which are over here.
It takes a little bit of time.
Yeah. I can't remember what's behind them, but it's mostly just like some free guys and some probably extra bugs and stuff.
Yeah, it's just all the,
Yeah. There's a lot of like, you'll get put back into one of the other rooms you're supposed to go in, but from a different door. Makes it even more tricky. Start getting turned around. And you do have to kill all the guys before you can go in the doors.
It has the cool music too. We can't hear the music that well, but it's like, it's got this wicked cool.
Yeah, you know, we haven't talked about that much, but I think the game has every single song from the movie, right?
It has an awful lot of them. Hans Zimmer, their studios wrote, the audio director and composer for Westwood Studios is Frank Kopacki, who now works at Petroglyph, and he's my cousin. And he ended up getting a letter from the Hans Zimmer Studios complimenting them on the music treatment for The Lion King on Super Nintendo.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, and then the thing for me was, like, there's a lot of the game, a lot of the instrumental songs from the movie are in the game, and those have become, you know, like, actual songs now in the musical version that
have
lyrics and stuff like that, and so it was nice to hear.
Well, they had lyrics at the time. You know, we had all the music from the film that was, a lot of it didn't make it in as well, so.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so all the music, none of them were, I don't want to denigrate Frank's efforts at all, because he did such a great job, but I don't think any of the music was actually his creation. All of it was either taken, lifted, or inspired by the things. It's just that he had to make it work on hardware at the time that was really challenging to get the kind of quality that you're looking for.
Yeah.
And we constantly were battling over assets on the machine as to how much room for music and how much for things. And music doesn't compress very well, actually.
Now we are actually at one that I'm not sure. I think it's the left. Let's try. Maybe? Yeah, I think this is the final battle, right?
The bugs. You know what? You're way beyond my memory.
Let's get that bug.
So sorry about the coughing, guys. I know it's gonna.
All right.
I'm just really enjoying this.
Me too, and this is going much better than it did last time. All right.
There it is.
Final level.
Fried rock.
Oh my goodness. Okay.
No save points on this one. You got to beat Scar.
I think there might be a few, but we'll see. It's
he
definitely
runs away
tough.
From you, right?
He runs every time, right?
Right. It's the final battle where there's no save points.
I love that the block that he does too.
Yeah.
I think I was thinking of the Aladdin level where it's all fiery escape from the Cave of Wonders. That one had no save points, and man, that was tough. But yeah, this looks really good.
We were pretty fair. I mean, it was hard, but it was pretty fair. There was Seth was always big on that. Was one of the things he didn't like about Aladdin was the fact that there were some places where you just, there's no way for you to have known what to do. Mm-hmm. You just had to be lucky or whatever. And then there were a couple places where it was really, really a combination of several really hard things and no real ability to...
That's not what I wanted to do. You know? Back to the beginning. But now we got that bug, I guess.
And no, no.
Gotta get rid of some of those guys. We've got too many.
You don't want to max out your guys?
Yeah.
Why show off, right?
All right, come on.
And I don't remember if the you're building up your roar, but I don't remember if you ever got his. There used to be a time when we had a scar meter, but I don't think we do anymore in the game, right? There's no scar meter.
I don't think so.
Yeah, no.
He does like the whole fight is just wearing him down to where.
Yeah, there was at one point in time during development we had a meter for him, and I think it just confused people. So.
That is interesting, though, because I think the first time I played it, I got him all the way worn down and didn't realize it and just kept hitting him. Ooh, that's right, going to make things challenging. All right, there we go.
There you go. Oh, the lightning strikes. Oh.
Let's go this way.
There it is. Yeah. Take the high road.
Okay.
Yeah, the lightning strikes. Those are brutal, too. So fun.
All right, getting there.
Yeah, you're getting very close. I mean, this is amazing. I can't believe you clearly wasted a lot of time playing this game.
I thought it would.
Oh no!
Okay, where am I now?
No!
I think this way.
Yeah, this is the one. High road again.
Okay. I just want to get a checkpoint. That's the worst, is that having to fight Scar every time at the beginning again.
Yeah. I love the subtle, although it's not so subtle on this television, but the glow, it kind of strobes on this, but the glow of the rocks from below is so fun. Right. And this is it.
This is it. You're right. There are no checkpoints.
I thought it was.
Maybe there is one more fight. I'm sure we'll see.
I'm pretty sure this is where you flip them off the edge. Yeah. Maybe not.
There's a path there. We'll see.
But there might be, I think, that if you climb up that, there might be like a health or something. I'm not, it's been a while.
We'll see. Yeah, it's a while for me too. Okay. Yeah, so we talked a little bit about this, but the big thing with the Scar battle is we're really just wearing him down to eventually be able to throw him off the end of the ledge, right?
Right.
Just like in the movie.
And although, exactly, and although you wear him down, to throw him over your back. Oh, there he goes.
Yeah.
Okay, so yeah, you do have to climb up. It's up higher, yeah. There's another hyena down there. I'm not sure.
Is this a bug? Because if so, I really need that.
Trying to remember. Yeah, there's a bug up there. Yeah. This is the, sort of the... That's what I thought was up there, health.
Yeah.
So, so that wasn't the final battle yet. Because you're on the edge of Pride Rock when you have the final battle.
Oh, gosh.
Oi.
Yeah, exactly. That's right.
And so the funny thing about that is, you know, for it to work like the film, you have to actually throw him over your back while you're on the edge.
Mm-hmm.
So even though you worn him down and you can toss him over your back all day long, you have to get him over to the edge of the rock so you can throw him off the side.
Yeah, exactly. So I feel so smart the first time I figured that out.
Yeah, if you had seen the film, you know, it's like, okay, well.
Yeah, and exactly. Like, I remembered from the film that happens. But that move was still something that I just hadn't quite figured out. Great, now I don't know how to get through this path.
There you go.
There we go. Okay, my health is not in great shape. I don't think it's gonna take too much, though. Just gotta get him panting.
Yeah, you gotta beat the hell out of him, too. It's not like.
Yeah, that's why I keep trying to maul.
Yeah, because the maul does so much more damage, yeah.
Hitting all those fire.
And when he blocks like that, yeah.
Not.
Whoa.
Oh! Oh! Okay.
Dad? Dad!
Help! Yeah, I know.
Yeah, this is the level. You do have to go start over again. Sorry about that.
Well, a lot of that was just I hit a lot of those fire steps.
Yeah, the lightning, it wears you down, see, you know?
Yeah, and I don't remember the exact path through them to get.
There is a way to go without ever taking a risk, but it's, you gotta really. Yeah, and you're just like.
There we go.
Slap him around, you There you go.
Oh. And then that happens. Very first jump. Oh. That's how it always is with those swinging sections. Once you get on one, then it's kind of like muscle memory takes over. Yeah, but
the first jump, it can always... Oh, I love that.
Yeah.
You see those things that pushes them off and stuff?
Yeah, I think there's like if you try to do the flip move to him too early, he'll flip you back or something.
Yeah, there's a bunch of these cool animations that, yeah. And those, that stuff, I mean, all of that stuff is precious. It takes a lot of space. There he is, he's panting. So that's supposed to be, teach you enough to go, okay.
Same thing.
Teach you enough to say, okay, that's how you get him to pant and beat him away, you know? You have to.
Yeah.
So the idea was, hey, you fight him at least a couple of times so you know that he's, you know how to get him to be retreating, but you don't know how to finish him off, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah, the whole raking thing is like, oh.
There we go.
There's far less orange fur than I remember, too. I'm wondering if they made us take most of that out, too.
Yeah, I mean, I remember after playing the Aladdin ones and seeing how different they are, I played them through Lion King on Super Nintendo, too. I don't remember it being vastly different.
Oh, no, it was the same code base. I mean, we were... Westwood was as a business strategy, we were a multi-platform developer, so we were always working on techniques to, you know, leverage the assets as well. Although most of the assets had to be retouched by hand because the systems were significantly different.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't remember if we had to get both approved, but my guess is that I'm almost certain that we would have probably had to submit the assets both on the Nintendo and the Genesis for approval. Disney Interactive actually helped with some of the artwork too. I should say Patrick Gilmore, who was the producer over there, was instrumentally involved with the game itself and had his team help with setting a style tone for the art for the characters. That really helped, I think, up the level a bit. So our team was awesome at executing, but I think they helped to really kind of push us, which was great.
Okay, back to this. I don't think I need, I might as well. Let's get it, just so we can.
It's kind of that's a free bug if you can do the wall jump. Because you're not taking, you know, despite the look of the flames, you're not taking any risk. I think the fall hurts very, very little, so.
There is even fall?
Yeah. I don't even know, I don't remember. If it hurts, it hurts enough, next to nothing. So this gives you an opportunity. Ah, darn.
Come on. Yeah, I can't take those hits from hyenas.
Yeah, because...
Goodness.
Shoot.
Too slow. Actually, if I clear back, I think it goes away.
I might have cleaned it up. Yep. There you go.
Dang it. All right, come on.
Yeah, you can't use the same techniques you did before. You have to really wait for them. And it's tough because you're trying to get through level and trying to get up there. And
yeah,
it's like...
All right. No!
Yeah, it's like there's a certain pattern where you have to like intentionally miss a platform to catch one that's lower, or you can go really quickly. If you get there before the strikes, that works too.
All right, we're up.
Yeah, and now you got at least a little bit of health.
Those malls, we gotta get a lot of those in. Come on.
Yeah, the counter strikes are what's hurting you now. It's like, oh.
Dang it. And that was an accidental roar, too.
Accidental roar.
All right. We're at the final level already, though. Very exciting. Yeah.
Did you learn any things you didn't know from the game? Well, not about the game. He teaches me things about the game.
There's a lot of interesting insight into Disney and politics that we've been getting, for sure.
Yep. And decisions on how to build the product and...
Yeah.
Game design.
We're talking, the game had actual Disney animators working on it, so they had to draw over all of their animations.
Yeah, they literally would give us onion skins, and we would scan them. They were faxing them to us, so we would we'd take the faxes and stick them in a scanner, and we'd get the rough outline in a really horrible pixelated version, and then the artist would have to hand touch every frame.
Yeah.
So.
Well, okay, here we go. Come on.
I know.
Simba can. Simba can do anything.
Simba's a magical lion. There was a lot of that discussion, actually. Lions don't work like that. It's like, oh, come on. It's a game.
Lions don't talk either.
Exactly. Oh, that's helpful. Especially okay. adult male lions, they don't work this hard. They're around for the size.
Yeah.
It's hard. He's actually making it look easy, to be honest with you.
Okay. I have a pretty big health meter too. I think I got all of the.
Yeah. No, you got all the growth things. I'm pretty sure. Well, maybe not all of them.
Maybe not. I might have missed one.
Might have missed one or two. Yeah. That's another secret that's really important in the game. As you progress through the game, you increase the length of your health meter through secret stuff. And you can obviously complete the game if you've never done any of them. We tested that, but it's so much harder when you know, because you have to pretty much have perfect execution. Yeah, it wasn't
this time I'm not going to let myself get hyenaed.
Yeah.
Oh, God, oh, but I am going to get fired.
Yeah, that takes the stuffing out of him.
There we go.
There you go.
Whoa. That was close.
Yep. I love the way he hangs on that thing, just like,
how good are you at this game?
Not. We wouldn't be doing a playthrough with me. We would just be watching me in frustration with the monkey puzzle.
Goodness gracious.
Have you played the game all
through? Oh, I've played the game all the way through many times. Yeah. Many, many times. But it's just that. It's been literally since probably 1995. I think they eventually die out, too.
They do, yeah.
If you're patient like that, yeah. So you don't have to.
Yeah.
And then lightning does strike twice. So
yes.
Be careful.
Okay. This is right, the best we've been.
Come on.
Ugh. No. Spacing.
You will have to get away from him a little bit, too. Yeah. You got to kind of push him back a bit.
I'm trying. Yeah.
Yeah. There you go.
Whew, okay.
There you go. That's good. And that's where you need to be.
And
anyway,
he fell on me.
The coup de grace here.
Boom!
Yeah, booyah! And away he goes. Well done, yeah!
Alright.
Take that. Never mind.
It was, so that roll move where I threw him over is something that was just never taught through the game, and you have to figure that out.
A hold and throw, yeah.
Yeah, you have to like roll the buttons from B to C when he's panting.
Yep.
All right.
You learn it. You can do it throughout with all their cats along the way. So what happens exactly what you said is you have it happen occasionally. You go, how did I do that? How did I do that?
Yeah.
And eventually you figure it out. I think the manual might actually tell you.
I think it does, but I didn't realize
Nobody
the panting thing. Like, I think I was always trying to do it to the pumas while they were still at full health, and it wouldn't work. And so then,
yay!
We did it. All right, man.
There it is. And the majestic mane blowing in the wind. Oh, you have to trust me, it's majestic. We're just very far away.
Is it the same shot from before, or is this actually Simba now instead of
Mufasa? Exactly.
Yeah.
Very nice. And then credits roll somewhere along the line. But
it should right now, yeah.
It is, it's playing
Circle
beautiful music.
Circle of Life, I think?
I can't hear. I don't know. Could be.
At any point, did Greg sing Circle?
I would have if the volume was up a little higher when I was playing this week. I just could not help it. Beautiful. Beautiful. All right. You heard it here. Awesome, man.
Awesome.
Well, thanks for coming and playing.
That was great fun. Thank you so much.
Awesome. There you are.
There I am.
Right there.
Creative director, producer. There you go. Rob Povey.
I'm sure this is bringing up.
Oh, Ronald PK. I didn't mention him. So.
Yeah, what's the hmm? There's got to be stories behind all of
David,
this stuff.
David used to sit there and go, Just a little, I don't know, personality
That's the story.
Tick of him. It's a personality tick of his. He understands. It was great fun. Oh, yeah, look at all this. This is great.
Yeah, man.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that guy.
There you go.
Do you know any of these people anymore?
Yeah, where are they all now?
Actually, I know a whole bunch of them.
You probably know Donna, Tony, Samantha, and James Castle.
Yeah, I kind of know them. I know them.
Michael Giacchino, he's the Lost and lots of movies.
Great guy. And then there's the artwork, additional artwork from the Disney guys. They did a wonderful job. So, yeah, I mean, it's funny, I should go pull I'll go have to watch this online just to read through this again. There's Paul Carossi, who was very helpful, the producer over at Disney Animation Services, and I'm sure Anthony Michaels is going to be on there, right up on the top, so which he deserves that. I'll tell you, man, some of the animations they do for the characters, when you see how much they stretch the characters out and how much they distort them to get that extra feeling of motion, it's just incredible. It's like comparing, Boris Vallejo to something Neil Young. Neil was over at Virgin Interactive and ran the Yeah, I mean, the guys at Virgin didn't have a whole lot of to do with the actual game development, but of course they were our parent company at the time, so. And some of the people helped out. I mean, there's certainly good reason, like the testing group especially. So it was great fun. Well,
we did it without using a continue, too.
I know.
Crazy.
Awesome.
That's not how my practice run went. So.
All right, then.
Did you already know all the hidden areas?
Oh, he knew them all, yeah.
I think I missed some, though.
You missed some as you were
trying to rush
through.
Yeah. But yeah.
Take off Simba's skin at the end of my dungeon.
Yeah, no, oh, no, geez. Nothing like that. Yeah. Although that'd be funny.
Yeah.
They had some animations that they had some drawings in the animation studios over at Disney, you know, with like a lion skin rug, you know, with the characteristic scar on it.
Nice. Well, now I want to see all this concept art from those areas I got cut.
That's I know, crazy. Yeah, it's like all that went back to Disney. They got it all back. So the only thing that's left is what made it into the game. So
awesome.
There you go.
Things like after the release of the game, were you guys approached to do any other Disney properties?
Yeah, actually, no, let me talk about that. So after this game, we did
I'm gonna play again.
We did
while
a prototype.
You talk,
go ahead, yeah. We did a prototype of we did a prototype of Aladdin because we wanted to do Aladdin 2, and we took the cell animation, which was still available, Disney sent it to us, for the Aladdin game, and we built the Aladdin characters in 3D, 3D Studio Max actually, rendered them, and then animated them as bitmaps, as individual bitmap images, and the look was just spectacular. I mean, it was just like this incredibly crazy good look that, up until that time, I had never seen it. I don't think it had been done. And then, negotiations with Disney fell apart. We couldn't get to financial terms, so we never made the game. But interestingly enough, about maybe a year later, or maybe not even that long, Donkey Kong Country comes out and has the exact same look. Now, obviously, they're working at it at the same time, so great minds think alike. They didn't take it from us. But it was just amazing because it's like it was having that moment going, wow, we could really even push the art even further and make it look at, even at this, even with this resolution and everything, it's amazing how much different it looks when you've actually rendered the images with 3D. All the background art was all rendered in 3D and everything too, so it looked like a 3D version of Aladdin. So that was our last. What's that? The guys over at Virgin Interactive Entertainment, and they ended up being Shiny, and we were supposed to get their team support and their tools and everything, but they left to create Shiny, and so we got no help. So not their fault, but it was quite a challenge. I mean, one of the biggest things about this game is to have created such a high quality product with basically a core team of 13, 14 people. In the span of about 7 months, and about 4 of those months, we didn't have assets from the actual studio because they were working on the film, and weren't allowed to release them. So it was a really, really, I mean, the last few months were just an incredibly challenging race to the finish. And yet, I'm very, very proud of the game. It came out so well.
Yeah.
A lot of passion from the team.
There's just a lot of really interesting design stuff there. Like even like the first level, seeing how you introduce the hyena, and it's just one hyena, and that was so hard in the very first time. And then suddenly, two levels later, you're fighting like 2 or 3 or 4 at
a
time.
Exactly.
And then you get to be like adult Simba, and then hyenas are nothing.
Yeah.
So you're just slashing them around,
them
and it's just, I don't know. You see a lot of that kind of like. Yeah, not hand-holding the character, not overly tutorializing people and like slowly introducing mechanics that people think is kind of novel with like indie games of the last 5-6 years, but it's all
like,
right
no,
here.
We've been doing that a long time.
Yeah,
yeah, and then also there's a lot of art assets too, like trying to fit all these different, wildly different styles into one cartridge. So these cartridges were not very big. I don't remember how big this one was, but it was a constant source of debate. I do not think it was the largest one we could get.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was the second largest.
when you roar at them, it changes the way they throw you, but then they auto throw.
Yeah, so it's so it teaches you in the beginning, here's how you jump, here's how you duck, and then it's like, you're on your own.
Yeah, no, it's interesting to see how you guys
double
got around
jump.
Some limitations too, just because it seems like there's a lot of like, you'll use the rocks from the first level, but a color palette change and some new effects like makes them look totally different and
exactly.
fresh.
And like I said, you know, the Disney guys were amazed. And if you look at Aladdin, you can see a lot of reuse as well, but they were amazed at how many different styles we were able to get because our team was very clever. And we had the compression technology. The compression technology, interestingly enough, ended up being used to create the vector quantization stuff that we used for Command & Conquer.
Hmm.
So because we had compression for, the original one was done on a Dungeons & Dragons game we did called Dragon Strike. The compression algorithm was written on that. That was then used in Lion King and some of the other games we were doing, Lands of Lore and others, to get more assets and to load faster. because if you compress the data down, back then the actual drives themselves didn't have compression in the drives. So you would actually load a lot faster because your file would be half the size or a third of the size. So that same lossless compression was used to do the tokenized compression that allowed us to get full screen audio and video for single speed CD-ROMs. Even Blink couldn't do it at the time. I don't think it ever did, actually. So it wasn't until you had multi-speed CD-ROMs that other people were doing full-screen audio-visual things. And so I think, you know, certainly Command & Conquer was a very novel game based on the gameplay from Dune, so fantastic, not taking anything away from that. But as a title, Command & Conquer, I think, really benefited from having all those story elements from the CD-ROMs, and just wouldn't have been the same without all those assets. So it's funny how this stuff builds. It's a one of those things I tell people all the time is the way you make better games is you keep making games, right? If you can keep a team together and make a game and a game and a game and a game, they don't even have to be the same kind of games. You get muscle memory, if you will, but really team muscle memory, institutional learning.
And that's the hardest thing with games, is just keep making
games. Exactly. Yeah, and that's
everybody
off. Everybody's getting done, everybody else. Yeah, and it's as a business guy that's had to have those very hard calls, it's like, well, you build a team of 300, 400 people to push a game out the door, and then you go, well, I need 50 of these guys to work on the next one, and I've got nothing to put all those people on. So it's just, either that or you work on a small team that never scales. It just takes you a lot longer to get the games done. Or you have multiple projects going where you can move them from one to the other. So
that's
but
how
you're
we
right.
made it work.
I hate it. I hate the fact that you finish up a product and you go, wow, it was so hard to get all these people. And there's some people you probably are better off without, but the vast majority of them you want to keep.
Yeah. And it's work together really well.
Yeah, and they've got all that team memory, and you just it's really a painful reality.
Building up tools and tech and getting familiar with it.
And actually getting all of them.
The black ones kill you, and if you get close to them, you will die in
it's
one
very
hit.
Very easy.
So I try to stay away.
Like I was telling him, the testing department would go through and sweep all of them. And you're just like, you guys are psycho.
I don't know how you even get over that.
Yeah,
but I gotta continue. Awesome.
And then iconic things like the big skull and stuff like that. You know, there were certain signature items we had to have in the game, and I remember like going, all right, well, we got to figure out how to use this piece of the skull as some other pieces. Mm-hmm. And you talked about earlier, some of the background bones and stuff like that are actually foreground elements that have been palette shifted to be completely black, so they build up the backgrounds and stuff. I mean, the amount of work that went into getting this stuff to fit was just
incredible.
Yeah, you see
a lot of components that get reused in different ways.
Yeah. And yet try not to make it look like it's constantly repeating, too, which is obviously, a goal. And Disney animators, you know, they do this wonderful animation. They really don't want to approve animation that doesn't have a lot of frames. So we're constantly compromising, saying, well, we just simply have to cut some of the frames from the buzzard, because we need some more for this. And it was amazing. It was as much of a technical jigsaw puzzle back then as it was, an artistic exercise. Fun stuff.
Super fun. Well, I would probably just play all the way through again if I sat here. So.
Well, maybe we got to call this one an end. So.
All right.
If you ever want to play through Blade Runner, I'd love to see that again.
Dude, I don't think I've ever played it, and I love that movie.
Well, it has 47 endings, so depending on which way you play it, it's going to be pretty different. It's a story
That's
simulator.
That's a perfect Let's Play game.
What's that?
Does anyone speedrun Blade
Runner? I don't think anybody can, actually. It's a game. It's a story simulator, and so it's almost... Actually, I would even say impossible to get the same game twice, because at the beginning of the game it randomizes the replicants and the replicants and humans. So unless you, it was a PC game. Yeah. We never put on anything else. by then the Atari, the Amiga, and the Atari had passed, and the only opportunity was PC. We didn't do. So Westwood did sports games on consoles, and then we did some platformers. Did a game called Young Merlin, which was kind of an adventure game on a console on the SNES. And then we did a bunch of tools for Sega that ended up going into Sega Technology Labs. In fact, actually, this game contributed a bunch of those too. So, art tools and stuff. So.
Bring back good memories, bad memories.
Oh, great memories. Yeah, I'm an optimist, and so I'm sure there's all sorts of horrible stuff that I've forgotten, and I'm very happy I forgot it. it's like I can tell you this, that whenever we'd have a really bad day for whatever reason, I would go over to Seth's. He had an apartment over there right by the office, so we'd stop by the office before I went home, and I'd have a pint of ice cream, and I ate a lot of ice cream. So I know there were bad days. Just literally sit down with a spoon and eat, and he'd go, "What happened?" I go, "Tell you about it later." I'm eating my ice cream right now.
Yeah. What was the reception like to the game? I mean,
oh, it was phenomenal.
There wasn't an internet then, so I don't know if like my experience was different than others, or if there was millions of people having the same exact experience. But it seems like now it's a game.
This
people
level,
talk about
especially,
a lot.
I mean, this is not. I have to say, on the Genesis, this is not nearly as good visually as it was on the Super Nintendo, because there was a hardware trick we got to use on the Super Nintendo where the two canyon walls were actually smooth scrolling gorgeously. I mean, it was just amazing to get that 3D. And this is an interesting little thing too. Oh, those little animations. Mm-hmm. The wildebeest stampede. This is actually a harken back to a game that when Brett Sperry and I first met, I was doing on an Apple II. I was doing a game called Bloodstone, and it was a guy running in a 3D maze from behind, where you would dunk under and jump over blocks on an Apple II, and it was not full screen, but about a third of the screen. It was actually, Brett was like, wow, how did you do that? And so I started talking about how I was buffering this display and everything. And so actually it started our friendship. So this is like sort of my homage to how Brett and I first met and got to be friends. So.
That's awesome. Yep, this is a rad one. Yeah, all right, man. Really fun. Well, thanks all right. for coming by. And I'm glad we were able to play all the way through. It was super fun.
It was great. Thank you.
Cool.
It was good fun.
Yeah.